If these dead trees located on Oregon Beach south of the town of Niskoan could speak, their last moments would have been marked by screams. While initially appearing as fairly unassuming, their presence marks only a small portion of a horror from a disaster of unimaginable scale. This disaster occurred 2,100 years ago, creating dozens of the so-called ghost forests, some of which are more than a mile inland, in an event which instantly doomed millions of trees spanning a 620-mile-long patch of ground that stretched from Eureka, California, all the way to the western portion of Vancouver Island in Canada. All of this was caused by the fact that over a time span of 3 to 5 minutes, the ground across an area of 55,000 square kilometers, or about the size of the state of West Virginia, sunk by between 2 and 6 feet. While the vast majority of the subsidence occurred underwater, a small percentage occurred on land, causing what were previously healthy forests a few feet above sea level to have their base suddenly submerged below sea level. After a devastating tsunami followed, inundating areas up to 10 miles or 16 kilometers inland, the trees were covered with salt water which was toxic to them, quickly killing them off. Their petrified remains then remained below the high tide level for hundreds of years until a combination of freshly emplaced sediments and long-term uplift caused the shoreline to move further out to the west, exposing petrified remains. What is so horrifying is that there are multiple examples of these forests which have differing ages. For example, while the aforementioned Niskoan Ghost Forest formed around 100 BCE, the Copalis Ghost Forest formed in 1700. And there are additional large subsidence events which have occurred between the creation date of these two separate ghost forests, meaning additional ghost forests could have formed around the year 400, 700, 1150, and 1470. The cause for each one of these disasters was an earthquake of unimaginably large size, specifically what is referred to as a megathrust earthquake on the Cascadia subduction zone. These major earthquakes, which range from 7.5 to 9.2, seem to repeat about once every 250 years, although the interval between major magnitude 7.5 plus events has recently ranged anywhere from 30 to 580 years. And 324 years on from the last major Cascadia megathrust earthquake, there are now 20 million more people which live here than when the previous one struck. This is the story of what the next major Cascadia subduction zone earthquake could look like and the damage it might cause. To make things easier to understand, I will be, in essence, looking at how the modern west coast of the United States and Canada might fare by superimposing the exact same damage, tsunami heights, etc. from 1700 in the modern world. Whereas the last megathrust earthquake in the subduction zone occurred around 9 p.m. local time on January 26, 1700, let us hypothetically assume that the next megathrust earthquake takes place at 9 a.m. local time on a future date. On a future date, the sustained motion of the two tectonic plates that comprise the offshore Cascadia subduction zone were occurring as usual. There, the one day Fuca plate was subducting underneath the North American plate. Over the past more than 300 years, the friction generated by the subducting Juan de Fuca slab pulled down on the overlying North American plate, causing a section of it to begin bending towards the subducting slab's motion. Eventually, sufficient stress built up that it overcame this friction, suddenly causing the overlying plate to snap back upwards. The time was now 9 a.m., and a magnitude 9.0 earthquake had been generated. The epicenter of this event was a spot at 13 miles or 20.9 kilometers depth, approximately 48.5 kilometers west of Lincoln Beach in Oregon. As a simultaneous rupture occurred along a whopping 620-mile-long stretch of the slab, it rapidly sent P and S seismic waves outwards in all directions at speeds of 5.5 and 3.1 kilometers per second, respectively. As this occurred, the snap upwards of the North American plate displaced a large mass of overlying water in the ocean, resulting in the generation of a towering tsunami. 5.4 seconds later, a seismic station 18.2 miles away picked up a strong spike from the earthquake's P wave, quickly sending a signal to a server, which then, all within a second, sent millions of alerts to every phone with current internet access, warning that a major earthquake was ongoing and that soon major shaking would begin. 8 seconds later, the initial P seismic wave struck one of the closest towns to the epicenter, Lincoln City. This caused the ground to shake back and forth in a strong manner for 11 seconds, after which the more damaging P waves arrived, causing the shaking to largely become an up-and-down motion that accelerated to 50% the force of gravity. Other seismic wave types, aka the L and Raleigh waves, followed not long after, further increasing damage, meaning that inside structures, most items fell off of shelves, most heavy furniture was overturned, and many light fixtures fell or repeatedly slammed back and forth into the ceiling. Outside, as some roof tiles were knocked off, many chimneys would collapse and scatter into a field of bricks, with a few cracks appearing in some building walls and foundations. And this would only be for wooden and reinforced steel buildings. If you would be unlucky enough to find yourself in a non-reinforced brick structure, it would be likely to completely collapse, with a slightly less but still high chance of this occurring in a concrete structure. This strong shaking would last for a prolonged 5 minutes, which would feel like ages for whoever was unlucky enough to experience this disaster. What I just described was MMI-8 damage, which would affect major cities such as Crescent City and Newport. MMI-7 intensity shaking would be felt in Seattle, Portland, Tacoma, Medford, Redding, and Victoria. MMI-6 shaking will be felt in Vancouver, Klamath Falls, Chico, and Port Hardy, while MMI-5 shaking will be felt in San Francisco, Sacramento, Reno, and Bend. Any city experiencing an MMI of 5 or higher will receive some form of damage, while those experiencing 7 or higher would see many masonry structures collapse. Alongside this physical damage, millions if not billions of trees would topple, and tens of thousands of landslides would be generated, wiping out hundreds of thousands of structures across a region from Vancouver to Redding. These landslides could occur in any region experiencing at least MMI-4 shaking, although it would be vastly more common the heavier the ground motion was. Areas with steep and rugged topography would be most at risk. And if you happen to live on a beach close to an active river or in an alluvial plain above sediment which held any type of water, the structure you lived in could face another hazard that in a worst-case scenario might cause it to collapse. Why? Well, this wouldn't occur in every potentially at-risk region, the underlying soils which contained abundant groundwater largely held together by friction could shift, causing water to come out of the mixture and subside unevenly in sections. This could cause the ground to collapse underneath the building in a process known as liquefaction, which would strike likely upwards of tens of thousands of buildings. Yet, while tens of thousands of casualties would have already taken place as the damaging S-waves took about the time shown on screen to reach select major cities, the main killer had not yet impacted yet, a massive tsunami. Between 20 and 35 minutes after the earthquake struck, the ocean would start to recede, going out upwards of 1,000 feet into the ocean more than it otherwise would. If you observed this phenomena of the ocean suddenly receding, you would only have a few seconds to, if you are lucky, a few minutes before the tsunami struck the shoreline. This towering tsunami would vary in height by location, but would largely be 13 to 20 feet tall in Northern California, 20 to 43 feet high in Oregon, 20 to 115 feet tall in Washington, 7 to 33 feet high on Vancouver Island, and between 5 and 30 feet high in the Salish Sea. Even Seattle will be impacted by an estimated 5-foot high tsunami. For example, here is where it is modeled to be inundated in Lincoln City, Crescent City, in Port Angeles. However, I must note that at the aforementioned location where a 115-foot high tsunami was suggested, some models suggest that tsunami heights could theoretically reach even higher, perhaps slightly upwards of 200 feet. Entire coastal towns will be inundated, with water soon flooding areas up to 10 miles inland, with the key factor being the area's topography. Tens of thousands more casualties would occur during this time frame. Multiple tsunami waves would strike across multiple hours, but as this was occurring, there would be a risk of another disaster. While not a certainty, it is reported that a single or group of major toxic chemical leaks could occur along a stretch of the Willamette River from industrial facilities, which, in a worst-case scenario, could kill 2,500 and injure 17,000 in Multnomah County. As the tsunami continued to expand across the Pacific Ocean, it would bring 10 to 20-foot high waves to much of Hawaii and almost certainly damage Hilo, and cause 10-foot waves to inundate part of several low-lying communities in southern Alaska, including Kodiak and Cordova. I want to note that a 10-foot high tsunami is vastly more dangerous than a 10-foot high wave, as unlike a wave, a tsunami is more like a temporary yet sustained sea level rise. Every area shaded in orange and red will be damaged by the tsunamis, which could cause fatalities in Samoa, northern Papua New Guinea, the Solomon Islands, Guam, the northern Mariana Islands, the east coast of the Philippines, Sulawesi and North Maluku, Taiwan, the Kuril Islands, and Kamchatka. Select areas of Japan would witness damaging tsunami waves up to 6 meters or 20 feet in height. By the time the tsunami waves diminish to unnoticeable levels, the damage and casualties are estimated to be as follows. 16,000 to 65,000 deaths, 25 to 30,000 injuries, 100,000 homeless, and damages of $270 billion. I want to add my opinion that I personally consider the $270 billion figure to possibly be a damage underestimate. This figure includes the additional damage the expected largest aftershock would generate, which would likely register between a magnitude 7.8 and 8.1, along with the thousands of lesser magnitude aftershocks that would occur. However, even as the rate of aftershocks declined, within several weeks, trouble could be brewing at another type of natural hazard, volcanoes. While uncommon, if MMI 5 or higher shaking occurs at a volcano which is already fairly close to erupting, it can trigger a chain reaction which results in a volcanic eruption within several days to months following a major earthquake. In 1700, this killed 3,000 due to an eruption of the CX cone in Canada, while in the United States, the Glacier Peak volcano soon erupted. While no Cascade Range volcanoes are currently primed for an eruption, a future hypothetical event could trigger a medium-sized eruption at a volcano such as Mount St. Helens, although this would be much smaller than its 1980 eruption. Of course, everything I just described is if a magnitude 9.0 to 9.3 earthquake occurs. The damage is likely to be much less widespread and severe if only a magnitude 7.5 event occurs. Regardless, there's about a 1 in 250 chance of a major Cascadia megathrust earthquake striking each year. As a final note, I would like to thank the EarthquakeSim YouTube channel for sponsoring this elongated video. He thought that insufficient coverage existed on this subject specifically on YouTube, which is why he sponsored today's video. EarthquakeSim frequently uploads content revolving around earthquake damage simulations and earthquake education, so I recommend that you check out his channel as mentioned in the video description and pinned comment. If you made it to the end, I appreciate it as it takes an absurdly long amount of time to make videos of this length.